This video is the fourth and last part of a video series on different Chipster tools for microbiome data tidying, visualization, and statistical analysis. Here we will focus on different statistical tools that can be used for microbial community comparisons. The first two methods I will discuss are Permanova and PermDisp. Both are abbreviations, with Permanova standing for permutational multivariate analysis of variance, and PERMDISP meaning a test for the homogeneity of multivariate dispersions. So as you can hear, there's a lot of terminology in here, and hopefully by the end of this video, concepts such as multivariate dispersion will feel more familiar. To start with, though, we can turn our attention toward what these two tests are generally used for and what kinds of questions they can help answer. In Chipster, Permanova is available both as a global test and a pairwise test. And a global test is used to test for overall differences between groups in a given dataset, and therefore as our first point of entry. One example of a question this test could help answer is, does community structure differ between sample groups? If we found out that such a difference does exist, it is possible to perform pairwise tests that help determine where exactly the difference can be found. A question pairwise Permanova might help answer is, which particular groups differ from one another in terms of microbial community structure. It is important to note that the Permanova results can be influenced by what we call location effects, as well as dispersion effects. I will go through the concepts of location and dispersion in more detail in the next slide. For now, though, I can mention that there is a separate test that is used together with Permanova called PERMDISP. PERMDISP stands for a test for the homogeneity of multivariate dispersions, and it is only run if we get a significant Permanova result. Running it can help us find out why exactly the Permanova result is significant. So in the last slide, I spoke about location and dispersion. The question remains is, what do these actually mean in practice? With the help of this slide, I hope to explain these concepts in a little more detail. As mentioned, Permanova results can be influenced by both. More specifically, a Permanova result can be significant due to a location effect, a dispersion effect, or a mix of both. The figure I have here is lifted from a very useful publication by David Wharton and colleagues, published in 2011 in the journal Methods in Ecology and Evolution. This slide contains a link to that paper if you would like to read it. The figure illustrates four different location versus dispersion scenarios that we might encounter when running Permanova. There are four plots, and each of these corresponds to a multivariate ordination. So you might remember that in video 3, we discussed how to interpret ordinations, such as the ones shown here. In each plot, there are two samples indicated by either circle or plus symbol shapes. The x and y axes correspond to arbitrary ordination axes and are shown without units. Each data point corresponds to a given microbial community, and the closer the points are to one another, the more similar they are in terms of community structure. The top left scenario corresponds to a situation where we have no location or dispersion effect. In this case, the data points are evenly distributed in the ordination space, and there are no clear differences between the groups, either in terms of where they reside in the space or in terms of how much variation we see within a given group. On the top right, we have a situation involving a location effect. Data points corresponding to one group are visibly separated here from the other group in the ordination space. This is what we refer to as a location effect. However, the two groups are very similar in terms of within sample variation. In other words, there is no dispersion effect. On the bottom left, we have no location effect, but we have a dispersion effect. Data points from the two groups overlap in the ordination space, but one of the groups, denoted by the circle symbols, shows less variation, less within sample variation than the other group, which is more widely distributed. Finally, then, on the bottom right, we have a scenario involving both a location and a dispersion effect. The two groups are separated in terms of where they are located in the ordination space, and the group on the left, denoted by circles, shows much less within sample variation than the other group. Running Permanova on its own cannot distinguish between location and dispersion effects, which is why it is often accompanied by PermDisp. Using those two tests together makes it possible to infer whether a significant Permanova result is due to location effects, dispersion effects, or a mix of both. So on this slide, I have a screenshot of Permanova results generated in Chipster. This is a text summary of statistical test output, and there are a few sections here that are particularly important for interpreting the outcome. At the top, under the word call, there is a row of text corresponding to the formula used to run Permanova. What is probably of most interest, however, is the section under the line saying terms added sequentially. Here we have some test results that could, for example, be used as part of a publication or report. So the column DF corresponds to degrees of freedom and provides us with information about the sample size used to perform the analysis. When reporting the results of tests like this, it is customary to list the degrees of freedom for both the variable being tested and the residual degrees of freedom, which here are 1 and 17, respectively. The column called F.model corresponds to the test statistic, which in the case of Permanova is called the pseudo F value. And that value tells us something about the magnitude, about the effect we've observed. The column called PRF corresponds to the statistical significance of the test, or the p-value. Conventionally, p-values of less than 0.05 are considered statistically significant. So in this case, the number reported is 0.001, which means that the p-value, or that the probability, is less than 0.001. Let's say that we have completed a global statistical test and it turns out to be significant, as on the previous slide. To find out where exactly the difference or differences lie, it is possible to conduct post-hoc pairwise comparisons. If we have a significant Permanova result, Chipster offers the possibility to run pairwise Permanova tests. Conceptually, these are similar to global Permanova, but with comparisons performed between individual sample pairs. If there is a significant PERMDISP result, this can be followed by a Tukey's honestly significant or HSD test. And since both approaches involve multiple testing, the test results are corrected for that, which means that sometimes the results can be somewhat conservative. The previous methods were all based on distance matrices. Another option for statistical comparisons of microbial community data in Chipster includes using the DESeq2 R package. DESeq2 is a method that originates from the RNA-seq field, but is increasingly being used by microbiologists. It is rather complex, mathematically speaking, and I won't cover the details in this video. Instead, we can focus on the types of questions it can help answer and the inferences we can make based on the output. Tests such as Permanova compare microbial communities as a whole, while DESeq2 can help us get down to the level of individual taxa. It can enable us to answer questions like which taxa are differentially abundant between samples, which in turn might allow us to make useful inferences about the data. For example, that some particular illness is associated with a decline in the abundance of specific microbial taxa in the human gut. While for distance matrix-based tests, we'd often use data that have been transformed in some way or another, with DESeq2, the situation is very different. Here, we would use untransformed data as the input, since the DESeq2 package features an internal correction for differences in sequencing library size. The results after running DESeq2 are given as log-fold changes in taxon abundance, and I have a useful link up on this slide if anyone would like to find out more detail on DESeq2. In the remaining parts of this video, we can focus on how the DESeq tool for microbial community comparisons is currently configured in Chipster. So currently in April 2021, the tool focuses on comparisons of two groups at a time. There may be situations in which the particular phenodata variable we are interested in contains more than two groups. And in those situations, it is possible to specify a pair. And this pair is named as group 1 and group 2. Running DESeq2 involves specifying a reference group against which the other group is compared. If comparing two groups, the reference group is selected alphabetically in Chipster. For example, B would be compared to A, or a group called sick would be compared against a reference group called healthy. When using a phenodata column containing more than two groups, the reference always corresponds to group 2. And so after running the DESeq2 tool, Chipster will produce a large table with log-fold changes reported as numbers. However, looking at that alone can be quite challenging if we want to make any quick inferences about the data. Because of that, a summary plot showing log-fold changes is also produced, and on this slide I have an example of one. The x-axis on the plot shows log-fold changes. These changes can be either negative or positive, so in this case the x-axis ranges from -8 to 8. The value 0 is indicated by a gray line on the plot to make interpretation of the results easier. On the y-axis is a list of different taxa, in this case at the order level, with the taxonomic classification level being possible also to specify by the user. Individual data points in the plot correspond to log-fold changes and have been color-coded according to the class level, with the taxonomic level used here also being possible to specify separately by the user. This type of plot serves as a useful overview of different taxon differences between sample groups, and it is also possible to download the more detailed results table from Chipster for further inspection. So that is a quick summary of statistical tools for microbial community analysis in Chipster. And this concludes the fourth and the final video in this series. So thanks for joining.